So let me start. In this presentation, I will be teaching you about the anatomy of the brainstem. So before you understand what is a brainstem, you should understand this is our brain. This brain is situated within the skull, and this is our spinal cord. Okay, this is our spinal cord. So what is brainstem? Brainstem is the part of the brain which connects brain to the spinal cord. So this portion which connects the brain with the spinal cord is known as the brainstem. Okay, am I clear? So what are the components of the brainstem? Brainstem has three major components. One is the midbrain. Second one is the pons. And third one is the medulla oblongata. Okay, so what is shown here? This is the brain, which has been removed. Okay, this is the spinal cord. So the brainstem is the connection between the brain and the spinal cord. And this brainstem has three portions. The cranialmost portion is known as the midbrain. Second one is the pons, and third one is the medulla oblongata. You should remember that behind the brainstem, we have our cerebellum. Cerebellum is removed from here. Okay, this is the cerebellum which is present behind the brainstem. The brainstem is connected to cerebellum by three bilateral rope-like structures. Okay, these rope-like structures are known as cerebellar peduncles. This is a schematic diagram, but as we go in the subsequent slides, we'll understand. So what you need to remember is brainstem is a connection between the brain and the spinal cord. Brainstem has three portions, that is midbrain, pons, and medulla oblongata. Behind the brainstem, we have the cerebellum. The cerebellum is connected to the brainstem. Each part, midbrain is connected to cerebellum, pons is connected to the cerebellum, and medulla oblongata is connected to cerebellum. And they are connected bilaterally. These connections are known as cerebellar peduncles. So we have, this is known as the superior cerebellar peduncle. This one is the middle cerebellar peduncle. And this one is the inferior cerebellar peduncle. So the superior cerebellar peduncle connects the midbrain to the cerebellum. The middle cerebellar peduncle connects the pons with cerebellum. And the inferior cerebellar peduncle connects the medulla oblongata with the cerebellum. You need to have this concept, because whatever pictures I'm going to show, in each picture, when I'm showing the front portion, I will remove something. When I'm showing the back portion, I will remove the cerebellum. So unless you have this concept that each part is connected to cerebellum by cerebellar peduncle, you will not understand. Someone is saying there is no video. Is my video clear or not? Am I audible or not? Okay, let me wait for a response. I think I'm audible and visible. At least in my mobile, I'm audible and visible. So I'm going to next one. So the same thing which I wanted to show you. The earlier picture was more of diagrammatic. So I'm trying to show this. As I've told you, see, I will again draw it diagrammatically. This is brain. Okay, this is spinal cord. This is only schematic diagram to make the concepts clear. So we have the brain and the spinal cord. The structures which is connecting the brain with the spinal cord is the brainstem. So let me draw the brainstem. So approximately think this is the brainstem. This is all schematic. The brainstem has three portions. First one is the midbrain, cranialmost portion. Second one is the pons, which is the mid portion. And third one is the medulla oblongata. Behind the brainstem, we have the cerebellum. So this cerebellum is connected to brainstem by three pairs, that is of the right and left. There are three pairs of peduncles. These are known as the cerebellar peduncle. So the superior cerebellar peduncle connects. Can I wait for the answer? So superior cerebellar peduncle connects what? I'm waiting for the answer. So superior cerebellar peduncle connects which part of the brainstem to what? Yeah. So it connects what and what structures? I want two structures names. So superior cerebellar peduncle is a connection between the midbrain and, everyone is answering midbrain, but it is connection between what? It is a connection between midbrain and cerebellum. Right. Second one. So the middle cerebellar peduncle is a connection between and third question. So what is inferior cerebellar peduncle? Yeah. So and middle cerebellar peduncle is a connection between pons and the cerebellum. So this is the middle cerebellar peduncle. And so the inferior cerebellar peduncle is a connection between the medulla oblongata and the cerebellum. This is the inferior cerebellar peduncle. So what I have shown you, so this structure is the brainstem. Let me draw the brainstem. Every one of you also try to imitate me. Try to identify the brainstem on the picture shown. Use your finger to draw. So this entire thing is the brainstem. Okay. So this portion has three components. So this one is the midbrain, this one is the pons, and this one is the medulla. So this structure behind it is the cerebellum. Okay. Can anyone answer me? What is this structure present between the brainstem and the cerebellum? There's a fluid filled structure present between the brainstem and the cerebellum. Can anyone answer me what it is? I'm giving you a hint. It's a fluid filled structure. I will give you one more hint. This is the lateral ventricle. This is the third ventricle. So third ventricle connects. CSF from the third ventricle goes here. So CSF from the third ventricle goes here. So this is the fourth ventricle. You are right. So this is the fourth ventricle. And this connection between the third ventricle and the fourth ventricle is known as the aqueduct of Sylvius. So once again, so this structure which you have just now told is the fourth ventricle. And this one, this narrow tube-like structure is known as the aqueduct of Sylvius. Is known as the aqueduct of Sylvius. So, one more question. So, aqueduct of Sylvius is present in which part of the brainstem? Is it present in the midbrain, or pons, or medulla? So aqueduct of Sylvius is present in which part of the brain? Right. Everyone is right. So aqueduct of Sylvius is present within the midbrain. And now come, let me see how much of you will answer. This is the fourth ventricle. This entire structure which you are seeing is the fourth ventricle. So third ventricle is connected to fourth ventricle through the aqueduct of Sylvius. So now tell me, the fourth ventricle is present behind which part of the brainstem? Fourth ventricle is present in which part of the brainstem? I'm drawing the fourth ventricle here. Okay. This is the fourth. Someone has answered pons. That is partially right. Can anyone answer in a better way? So this is the fourth ventricle. Okay, it is a tent-shaped structure. CSF from the aqueduct of Sylvius enters the fourth ventricle here, and outside the fourth ventricle, it goes out through a foramen, which is known as foramen of Meggenti. Yeah, this answer, majority have went wrong. The fourth ventricle is present in both parts of the brain. Fourth ventricle is present both behind the pons and also behind the medulla oblongata. That is, when you see this picture, when you go to the fourth ventricle here, so the lower part of the fourth ventricle will be formed by the medulla oblongata, and the upper part of the fourth ventricle is formed by the pons. So I think until now I'm very clear. Okay, am I clear? Someone is asking me to repeat. So I'm telling you, the aqueduct of Sylvius is present within the midbrain, whereas the fourth ventricle is present both within the pons and medulla oblongata. The upper part of the upper part of the fourth ventricle is present in the pons, and the lower part of the fourth ventricle is present within the medulla oblongata. So this part is a basic part of brainstem. So this is the front picture. This is a front picture. So I'm telling you, this is first one is the midbrain, second one is the pons, third one is the medulla. This is the front picture. Try to understand this picture. Each structure has a different shape. When you see the midbrain, it is something like an cross, something like a V-shaped structure. Okay, this is the midbrain. If you see pons, this is an horizontal triangle, like quadrilateral kind of structure. This is pons. And when you see medulla oblongata, it's just like a rostral cylindrical structure, which is a rostral continuation of the spinal cord. I will come back to this picture again. Yeah. Someone is asking foramen of Meggenti. Foramen of Meggenti is here. Foramen of Meggenti is here. Yeah, before, once again, let us deviate a bit. Before I go further, I need to tell you, you need to know what are the cranial nerves. So how many cranial nerves are there? Can anyone answer me? Everyone can answer me. So how many cranial nerves are there? So everyone is right. There are 12 cranial nerves. Okay, so you have to remember which cranial nerves come from what. So this is an easy thing. I don't believe much in mnemonics, but easy way to remember. One is the cerebrum. You will have to remember cerebrum. That is the main brain. Okay, apart from the cerebrum, we have how many parts of the brainstem you had? So we have the midbrain. Third one. We have the pons, we have the medulla. So what you have to remember is, from the cerebrum, two cranial nerves come. So out of the 12 cranial nerves, cranial nerve 1 and the cranial nerve 2 come from the cerebrum. From the midbrain, we have two cranial nerves coming. That is third and fourth. Pons, there are four cranial nerves. So what are they? 5, 6, 7, 8. And medulla oblongata, the remaining four cranial nerves. So is it clear? So from the cerebrum, which I have not shown, we have the cranial nerve 1 and 2. From the midbrain, we have two cranial nerves, that is cranial nerve 3 and cranial nerve 4. From the pons, we have four cranial nerves, that is cranial nerve 5, cranial nerve 6, cranial nerve 7, cranial nerve 8. And from the medulla, we have four cranial nerves, this is 9, 10, 11 and 12. So these four cranial nerves are known as the lower cranial nerves. So can quickly, every one of you, don't wait for others, just try to type names of all the cranial nerves. I will try to repeat it, but everyone try to repeat it. This is a mnemonic which I have found from the net. So this is mnemonic, to take a family vacation, go Vegas. And Hawaii. Go Vegas and Hawaii. If you are a fan of mnemonics, if you want to remember, remember it. But there's something basic which have this which you'll have to remember subconsciously and get it. No one is answering. I want everyone to type the names of all the cranials. So cranial 1 is olfactory. Cranial 2 is optic. Cranial 3 is oculomotor. Cranial 4 is trochlear. Cranial 5 is trigeminal. Cranial 6 is abducens. 7th is optic. 8th is vestibulocochlear. 9th is glossopharyngeal. 10th is vagus. 11th is accessory. 12th is hypoglossal. So, what is the function of the facial nerve? Quickly. I'm waiting for your answers. What is the function of facial nerve? Yeah, it controls the movements of the facial nerves. So, can anyone tell me what are the oculomotor nerves? What are the oculomotor nerves? What are the oculomotor nerves? What are the nerves which control the extraocular movements? There are three nerves which supply the extraocular movement. So, tell me the three names of the three nerves which control the extraocular movements. One is the oculomotor, which is cranial nerve 3. Tell me the names of other two cranial nerves which control the eye movements. Yeah, 3, 4, 6. Everyone is right. Now tell me the cranial nerve which controls our parasympathetic supply, which controls our heart. Cranial nerve which controls our heart. No, yeah, everyone is still stuck at the oculomotor nerve. I want the cranial nerve which controls our heart. Vagus, right. Everyone is right. Now tell me the cranial nerve which controls our tongue. Cranial nerve which controls our tongue. Right, everyone is right. Hypoglossal nerve controls our tongue. So let me just revise. Olfactory nerve controls our smell. Optic nerve controls our vision. Oculomotor 3, 4, and 6. They are concerned with our extraocular movements. Trigeminal nerve with the facial sensations. Facial nerve controls the facial movements. Vestibulocochlear nerve controls our hearing. Hearing and balance is by the vestibulocochlear nerve. Glossopharyngeal nerve controls our sensation of taste. Vagus is concerned with parasympathetic supply, that is, it controls our respiration, it controls our heart. Spinal accessory supplies our sternocleidomastoid. Hypoglossal nerve controls our mastication, tongue. So let us come back and count our cranial nerves. So this is the medulla oblongata. So we have two cranial nerves here. So this is cranial nerve 4 and this is the cranial nerve 3. Okay, so we have two cranials from the midbrain, which is the cranial nerve 3 and cranial nerve 4, which is the oculomotor nerve and the trochlea. Then from the pons, we have four cranial nerves. So we have the trigeminal nerve and three cranial nerves. This is the 5th, 6th, 7th and 8th. And from the brainstem, we have the remaining four cranial nerves. When I come to that particular structure, I will come back to the individual cranial nerves again. So let us compare a medulla oblongata. First, before I go further into medulla oblongata, tell me what is the gross function of the brainstem? What is the gross function of the cerebrum? Cerebrum and brainstem. So I will give you a hint. Your intelligence is controlled by your cerebrum or brainstem. You are right. All the higher mental functions and intelligence is controlled by the cerebrum. So what is controlled by the brainstem? I will wait for a minute. I want everyone to guess what are all the things which are controlled by the brainstem. I'll wait for one complete minute. Everyone try to type. Right. Brainstem controls all the involuntary movements. You are swallowing, breathing, heart response, all the functions of brain nerves, which I have told before, they are all controlled by the brainstem. Your intelligence, memory, calculation, music sense, spatial orientation, all these are controlled by cerebrum. I mean to say, all the basic things which you require for your survival are controlled by the medulla oblongata, and all the higher mental functions are controlled by the cerebrum. So coming to the medulla oblongata, this is the anterior view of the medulla oblongata. So when you see from the anterior structure, you can see three elevations which are seen in the medulla oblongata. All the three elevations are very, very important. The elevation which is present in the midline is known as the pyramid. This pyramid carries the pyramidal fibers. I'm pretty sure that everyone who is in this webinar, everyone who has at least a basic knowledge of brain, has an idea what are the pyramidal structures. What is the pyramidal tract? So pyramidal tract controls your voluntary functions. It controls your muscles. So the pyramidal tract fibers from the cerebrum in the brainstem, they pass through the pyramid. So these two medial structures are the pyramid, and you see the pyramid closely. So these are the pyramidal tract fibers which are coming. But when you see them closely, the pyramidal tract, there's crossing over the fibers here. This crossing of fibers is known as decussation. So this is very important. So this is the pyramidal decussation. The pyramidal decussation occurs at the level of the brainstem. In the brainstem, where does it occur? It occurs in the lower part of the medulla oblongata. This is very important. So let's imagine this is right, this is left. Suppose there is injury to the pyramid above the decussation. Okay, so I've cut the pyramid at this level. So patient will have weakness on the right side or left side? Right or left? This is transection at A. I have transected left pyramid at the level of here, where I have shown you. So let us say label A. So when there is injury at the level of A, patient will have weakness on the right side or left side? Someone said right side, someone said same side. So let me explain you. So this is the decussation which I have told you. So if there is an injury over here, you will have the loss of control on the opposite side. Am I clear? So when there is an injury at the level of A, which is on the left side, patient will have weakness on the right side. Suppose there is a transection at the level of lower part of the medulla. Transection in the B, there's a transection at the lower part of medulla. So patient will have weakness on the right side or left side? Yeah. When you're typing, answer me. B, same side. B, opposite side. Otherwise, I will not be able to understand whether you're answering for the first question or the second question. For B, the lesion is on the right side. Patient will also have weakness on the right side. So lesion will have weakness on the same side. So this is very important. So this is one of the basic part which you need to understand. Pyramid is a part of the medulla oblongata. Pyramidal decussation occurs in the lower part of the medulla oblongata. Any injury above the level of pyramidal decussation will cause a neurological deficit on the opposite side, and any injury below the level of pyramidal decussation will cause weakness on the same side. Okay, fine. So this is the second elevation which you are seeing is known as the olive. This green structure which you are seeing. This olive is connected to the cerebellum. How? Can you identify this third structure? Can anyone tell me what is this third structure? I have told you There are structures which connect the medulla oblongata with the cerebellum. So can anyone tell me, can anyone guess what is the name of this structure which you are seeing? So this structure is connecting. I'm seeing from the front side. So behind we have the cerebellum. Cerebellum we are not able to see in this picture. So this structure connects the medulla oblongata with the cerebellum. And what you have said is right. This is the inferior cerebellar peduncle. Okay, now tell me the what are cranial nerves coming from here. I've shown you before. So this is the pyramid. So between the pyramid and the olive, we have the cranial nerve 9. We have the cranial nerve 12, which is the hypoglossal nerve. Between the olive and the inferior cerebellar peduncle, we have cranial nerve 9, we have cranial nerve 10, and we have the cranial nerve 11. And this is the cranial nerve 12. So I think this is clear. So this is the cranial nerve 12. These are the successive cranial 9, 10, 11. So when I see medulla oblongata, you will have to remember this pyramid. There's an olive. There are four cranial nerves. Now let us see from behind. From the front side, you have seen 3 elevations. They were the pyramid. Next one was the olive. Next one was the inferior cerebellar peduncle. So from the anterior side, there were 3 elevations. So one was pyramid. Second one was olive. Third one was inferior cerebellar peduncle. From the posterior side, when I see from the posterior side, see this is a cut part of cerebellum, which I have removed. So after removing cerebellum, I'm saying from the posterior side, this is floor of the fourth ventricle. As I've told you, the upper part of the floor of the fourth ventricle is formed by the pons. The lower part of the fourth ventricle is formed by the medulla. So this medulla has 2 components, the upper part of the medulla, which is forming a part of the fourth ventricle, and the lower part of the medulla, which is closed, where the fourth ventricle ends. This part, which is closed component, also has 3 elevations. These 3 elevations are known as, this is known as a gracilis, nucleus gracilis. This is known as nucleus cuneatus, and this one is known as the lateral lemniscus. So from the posterior aspect, we have 3 elevations from medial to lateral. One elevation is known as cuneate, nucleus cuneatus. Other elevation is known as nucleus gracilis. Third elevation is known as the lateral lemniscus. These 2 structures, they form a portion of the dorsal columns. I think everyone here knows it. Someone is asking how large is pons, you can you draw it? When I come there, I will draw. The next portion will be the pons. When I come there, I will tell you. Let us concentrate on the medulla oblongata now. So this is very important. So on the posterior aspect, we are the nucleus cuneatus and the nucleus gracilis. And the structures which go through the nucleus cuneatus and gracilis is the dorsal column. So pyramidal tracts contain the motor functions. So every one of you should type what are the functions of the dorsal column. So what are the functions of dorsal column? I want an answer from every one of you. Right. Dorsal column are the posterior column. They supply proprioception. They control vibration. They control fine touch. Yeah, they everything except the crude touch and pain. Fine. So these are the sensory aspects. So the motor aspect was present in the anterior aspect of the medulla oblongata, and the sensory aspect is present in the lateral part. So similarly, what goes in the lateral lemniscus? Lateral meniscus carries the pain and touch sensation. So the lateral meniscus carries the pain and touch. One more thing which I want to tell you is, in the this part of the medulla oblongata, we have two triangles which are known as the hypoglossal triangle and the vagal triangle, and one structure which is known as the area prostrema. Area prostrema, this is the area prostrema, which is the tip of the fourth ventricle. This area prostrema is controls your vomiting center. So your vomiting is controlled in the is controlled by the area prostrema, and this is a vagal triangle, and so vagal triangle has a function which you already know. This is a cross section. I will try to cover it in the next session, because if I try to cover the cross section, it becomes too heavy and it's very confusing. So as I've told you, all this nuclei present in the medulla oblongata, nucleus gracilis and curiatus are concerned with the sensory functions. Spinal nuclear trigeminal nerve, which I have not told you, which I will tell you again in the trigeminal section. We have the vagus nerve, we have the accessory nerve, we have the hypoglossal nerve. We have the, all these structures are important, but I will tell you in the next section. Coming to pons. As I have told you, pons. First, try to see it from the anterior aspect and posterior aspect, lateral aspect and this one. Yeah, you can see. When you see from the lateral aspect, the pons has a swelling, as a belly. This belly is known as the pontine belly. This is like just like a pregnant woman. If you see, if you imagine the brainstem is like a pregnant woman, the belly of the pregnant woman is the pons. This you can appreciate in the lateral view. That is why I've shown you the lateral view. This is the pons. And when you see it from the anterior aspect, this is the pontine belly. This is the pons, which is known as the pontine belly. This pontine belly has horizontal striations. This has transverse striations, and in the midline there is a vertical groove. This vertical groove is known as basilar groove, and it lodges the basilar artery. And as we all know, basilar artery supplies all the brainstem. It supplies a major part of the brainstem. It forms a part of the posterior circulation. And why are these horizontal striations? This is because the pyramidal tracts from the cerebrum, they reach the midbrain. From the midbrain, they reach the pons, and some of the fibers of the pyramidal tract, they reach the cerebellum through the middle cerebellar peduncle. So these fibers we call corticopontocerebellar fibers. We call them corticopontocerebellar fibers. Because of these fibers, the pyramidal tract fibers, which go through the brainstem and reach the cerebellum. These fibers are known as corticopontocerebellar fibers. And because of these fibers, we have transverse striations on the pons. These are known as transverse striations on the pons. And this one is the middle cerebellar peduncle, which connects the pons to the cerebellum. So this is the middle cerebellar peduncle. So I think from the anterior aspect, it's very easy to recognize the pons. It is something like a quadrigeminal structure. It has a pontine belly, we have the transverse striations. And can you identify this groove? This is the pons and this is the medulla. This is known as the pontomedullary groove. At the junction of pons with the middle cerebellar peduncle, we have a very thick cranial nerve. Can anyone tell me what is the name of this thick cranial nerve? Pons has how many cranial nerve? 4 cranial nerve, 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th. So this thickest cranial nerve, which comes from the junction of the pontine belly with the middle cerebellar peduncle, is which cranial nerve? This is the 5th cranial nerve, which is the trigeminal nerve. And the remaining cranial nerves, we have the 6th, 7th, and 8th. 6, 7th and 8th. So as I've told you, 8th cranial nerve is known as the vestibular cochlear nerve. And so the vestibular cochlear nerve is concerned with hearing and the balance. Let us see pons from behind. So as I've told you, So the same picture, when absent, when it forms from behind, this is entire thing. This is cerebellum which has been cut. This is the entire fourth ventricle, the roof which I have removed, the tent-shaped structure. So we have the upper portion, the lower portion. The upper portion is formed by the pons, and the lower portion is formed by the medulla oblongata. The upper portion has an elevation in the midline, which is known as the median eminence. On the median eminence, there is one more elevation in the middle. This elevation, which you see in the middle, is known as the facial colliculus. This facial colliculus is formed because of a peculiar arrangement where we have the facial nucleus. Along the facial nucleus, we have fibers from the sixth cranium which winds around. Is it clear? This is the sixth cranial nerve. This is the seventh cranial nerve. So when the fibers from the sixth cranial nerve, as they come out of the brainstem, they wind around the seventh cranial nerve. This is known as neurobiotaxis. And what is the importance of neurobiotaxis? Whenever there is injury to the seventh nerve, there is also injury to sixth cranial nerve, because the sixth cranial nerve fibers go along the seventh nerve. So seventh nerve and the sixth cranial nerve deficits are very common at the level of the brainstem. So if some patient comes with a deficit of sixth and seventh cranial nerve alone, we'll have to suspect that the patient has some deficit in the brainstem. As I've told you, this is the middle cerebellar peduncle, which is connecting the pons with the middle with the cerebellum. We have pontine nuclei, which is present within the pons, the belly of the pons. From the pontine nuclei, the fibers reach through the middle cerebellar peduncle to the cerebellum. So this is cross section. Briefly, I will tell you. So this is the pontine belly. Pontine belly have pontine nuclei. Each one is a pontine nucleus. We have the fibers which were coming, pyramidal tracts which are coming from above. They reach the pontine nucleus. They synapse at the pontine nucleus. Then they enter the middle cerebellar peduncle and they reach the cerebellum. And this is all is known as the tegmentum of the pons. And this is the fourth ventricle. Coming to midbrain, which is last part of the midbrain, the superior most part of the brainstem is known as the midbrain. This midbrain has a CSFL structure which connects the third ventricle with the fourth ventricle. So what is the name of this? What is the name of this? Right. This is known as the aqueduct of Sylvius. So because of aqueduct of Sylvius, the midbrain is divided into two portions, the portion anterior to it and the portion posterior to it. So let us see first from anterior portion. So when you see from the anterior portion, that as I have told you, midbrain is a V-shaped structure. Okay, let me draw again. So this is our pons. This is our pons with the middle cerebellar peduncle. So we have a V-shaped structure, which is known as the midbrain. So each part of the V is known as a cerebral peduncle. So when I've said the brain connection between the brainstem and the cerebellum are the cerebellar peduncles. Cerebellar peduncles, which are of three kinds, as I have told you: superior cerebellar peduncle, middle cerebellar peduncle, and inferior cerebellar peduncle. But these are cerebral peduncles. They're not cerebellar peduncles. They're cerebral peduncles. So the two cerebral peduncles, they form a part of the midbrain. And the structure in between them, this V-shaped notch, is known as the intercerebral peduncle, because it's between the two cerebral peduncles. We call that intercerebellar peduncle. Okay, when you see from the behind, we have four elevations. These elevations are known as colliculi. So we have two superior colliculi and two inferior colliculi. The superior colliculi, two, they form a part of the vision. They help in pupillary reflex. Am I clear? So superior colliculi, they are concerned with vision and they help in pupillary reflex. Am I clear? So there are four colliculi, the superior colliculi and the inferior colliculi, and the superior colliculi are concerned with the pupillary reflex. And there are two cranial nerves coming from here. This is cranial nerve 4 and this is the cranial nerve 3. So as I've told you, when you see the cross section, so what you have to see, these V-shaped structure, these are the peduncles. Again, these peduncles, like the pontine belly, they carry the pyramidal trunks. This is the aqueduct of Sylvius. Behind the aqueduct of Sylvius, we have the four colliculi. All the four colliculi together are known as the tectum. The part of the midbrain between the aqueduct of Sylvius and the cerebral peduncles is known as the tegmentum. So the midbrain, the cross section has three components, the tectum, the tegmentum, and the peduncles. There are two more important structures we have to remember. This structure, which you are seeing between the peduncle and the tegmentum, is known as the substantia nigra. We call that one substantia nigra. I think every one of you know, what is the function of substantia nigra? Yeah, crest cerebri is also known as cerebral peduncle. Cerebral peduncle is nothing but a crest cerebri. As Dr. Sakwal was asking, what is crest cerebri? Crest cerebri, the other name of crest cerebri is the cerebral peduncle. So this is substantia nigra. I want every one of you to tell me what is substantia nigra. Yes, Dr. Sakwal is saying it secretes dopamine. That is right. So it secretes dopamine. If there is injury, not injury, if there is a degeneration of substantia nigra, what does it cause? Yeah, everyone is right. Substantia nigra secretes dopamine. A decrease in dopamine content causes what? Right, Parkinson's disease. One more structure. So let me clear. So substantia nigra is a part of midbrain, and degeneration of substantia nigra causes Parkinson's disease. There's one more structure which I'm showing here. This structure is known as the red nucleus. Red nucleus has connections with cerebellum. So what happens in injury to red nucleus? So injury to red nucleus causes what? Injury to the red nucleus. Very few people are telling. Actually, I didn't get an answer. So whenever there's an injury to red nucleus, no, it doesn't go decerebrate posturing. Any other try? It causes a specific structure which are known as rubral tremors. Yeah, you can also say there is, it has some control with the flexor muscle control, accepted, but a gross condition called rubral tremors, which are very violent tremors, which are not usually seen after trauma, but usually seen in some degenerative conditions. And there is something known as periaqueductal gray matter, which I will tell you in what is the function of PAG, I will tell you later on. So this is a gross picture. This is a substantia nigra. This is known as the crest cerebri, the cerebral peduncle. This is known as the tegmentum. This is the tectum, and this is cerebral aqueduct. Yeah. So this completes my anatomy of the brainstem. I don't want to teach the entire anatomy in a single session because it's very complicated and you will get fed up. So So let me take questions now. If you have any questions, you can answer now. You can ask me now. Let me see, were there any questions until now? Okay. Actually, everyone has only answered it. I couldn't find any questions in the phones. Sorry, mid-brain phones. Well, I'm not finding any questions here. Everyone has answered very well. I can't find anyone answering, giving a wrong answer. Yeah, Dr. Sakpal is asking what is the function of red nucleus. You have the rubral tract, which I'll be telling, covering when I'm teaching about the descending tracts. The rubral tract has a control of the flexor muscles. It controls the flexor muscle tone at the same time. It also has a connection with the cerebellum. So whenever the red nucleus is injured isolated, it causes rubral tremors. The fineness of the movements are lost. Patient will have very violent tremors. And also there will be an increase in the flexor muscle tone. Dr. Sabha is asking what happens if sixth nerve is injured but not seventh. Sixth nerve can be injured independent of seventh. Both sixth and seventh brain nerves are very near to each other at the brainstem. As I've told you, the fibers of the sixth nerve, they bind around the seventh nerve. So they are present when there is an injury of the brainstem. Sixth and seventh nerve injured together, but after exiting from the brainstem, sixth nerve travels through the subarachnoid space and reaches the cavernous sinus. From the cavernous sinus, it reaches the extraocular movements. There's a mnemonic. Sixth nerve supplies the lateral rectus, SO4, LR6. So whenever there's injury to sixth nerve, there is impairment of the lateral rectus. So the lateral movement of the eyeball is lost. So when there's injury of sixth nerve without injury of seventh nerve, the lateral rectus is impaired and the lateral movements of the eyeball is lost. Any other questions? Yeah, lateral rectus is injured, accepted. Any other questions from you all? I think this time I didn't have any technical glitches. This software is good. So from the next time, I'll continue with this software. Dr. Srinivas is asking petroclival. I didn't understand that. Yeah, whenever there's a petroclival meningioma excision, usually the sixth nerve is injured. Either sixth nerve is injured or even the fourth nerve is injured. Sometimes even the fifth nerve. Thank you everyone. Even though last time I have made a big mistake, I could present properly. There was software glitches, but this time probably everything went on well. Next time I have designed a curriculum for the entire neurology and neurosurgery one, which covers both the basics and clinical things. I've selected some of the topics which are important from physiotherapy point of view. So I will be putting that in the group. If everyone has not been a part of the neurosurgery webinar group, kindly be a part of it and kindly subscribe to my channel, because whenever I go live, it becomes easy for you to get a alert, and also it becomes easy for you to log on. Thank you everyone. Thank you and good night.